All right, my friends, we are back. It is May 1st. We got Phil Jones here again. How you doing, my friend?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing awesome. I want to talk more HDMI 2.1 with you. So I want to talk about the features, what you're going to expect, and hardware compatibility. What do you think about that?
I think that's a good idea. I mean, it's nice to break it up into kind of more bite-sized chunks so we can work our way through all of this madness.
Awesome. So you put together this great slideshow presentation. I'm basically now going to share my screen and we will go over what you have here for us.
Okay.
Entire screen.
So last week we talked about 4K and 8K and bandwidth and what's inside of the cable that you're buying. And a lot of times when you hear 2.1, we hear a lot about 8K, 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 but a lot of your viewers, members probably aren't even in the market right now for an 8K TV. But there's a lot of other features that are available in HDMI 2.1 that you're going to want to utilize now. And there's a lot of display. There's a lot of components you already have that can still be used in that 2.1 system. So I want to go over the features that are beyond resolution and bandwidth and let people know what those features are and show you how you can incorporate older products into the systems with newer products. Okay. So let's get, awesome. If you don't know, I'm the director of training for Sound United, which is all the brands you see there below, Denon and Marantz Class A, Polk Audio, Boston Acoustics, and Definitive Technology. So I've been doing this for a while and I get asked a lot about this. So I wanted to cover it with you guys. All right, so let's get started.
Awesome. Okay, well, before we continue, I just want to say I'm hearing some audio breakup. I'm not sure if it's coming out through YouTube or if it's just through StreamYard. So we're going to continue anyways, but if anybody complains about the sound, I'm going to have to send some hired help to knock you guys down. So just enjoy what we got for now.
Yeah, it is I hear a little crackle too, but hopefully we get through this. Okay, so we talked about the fact that there's this new HDMI specification, HDMI 2.1, which replaces the 2.0B that came out with 4K HDR and 4K 60p content. So the first thing we talked about is why do you need a new specification? The first thing was better video and audio because of more bandwidth. You have higher resolution and higher frame rate. But there's also some other things that are going to give you better video and audio, the experience, the user experience, as well as enhanced gaming. So today we're going to talk about those other things that are going to make using a system that has HDMI a lot more friendly, usable, and nicer. So let's talk about that. So let's go on the next slide.
Okay. And one thing I want to say, if anybody has any cable questions on HDMI 2.1, we already covered this in the last one. I'll link it down below. So hold off on your cable questions and just check out that video that we've already done.
Yeah. Yeah. So Kurt says that it is kind of crackling. I'm clean, Gene. You're not. Okay. So the first thing we want to talk about is, we have these new sources coming, and right now there's only two sources that have been announced that can support HDMI 2.1. They have enough resolution and frame rate capability. Of course, if you're a hardcore gamer with some crazy NVIDIA thing, that is another source. But the common source you're going to walk down to a Best Buy or a retailer and buy are going to be first game systems like the new PlayStation and the new upcoming Xbox, which both support 8K 60 and 4K 120 for gaming. And after talking to a bunch of gamers, a lot of the gamers are far more interested in the 120 frames per second than they are with the 8K. They would rather spend the bandwidth on that because the smoother the game, the less the lag, the more of an advantage I have. So that's more of a thing that they're interested in. So if you continue on. But when you walk into the trade shows and you walk on the floors, all you see is 8K, 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 or high frame rate. How many frames per second? Because it's easy for a TV company to communicate. Just like AV companies use watts and channels all the time. Because if four channels is good, eight channels must be better. So if 4K is better, 8K must be better. So you'll hear a lot of that as the thing that they talk about, but we want to talk about the things you're probably going to use more often. So let's talk about the things beyond resolution and frame rate. So continue on. So the first thing, there's features that I kind of divided up that I say that are more focused on enhanced gaming, and there's features that are more focused on making a movie viewing or an audio experience better. Now, it's not saying that these features are not going to make, these gaming-based features aren't going to make your video better, but it's more designed for gaming. So the first thing, variable refresh rate. And what this does is, we'll talk about it in more detail. It basically allows the computer to, it looks at the frame, and if the there's not a lot of motion, it can spend more time building a sharper frame. When there's a lot of motion going on, it can vary its frame rate based on whether there's a lot of motion or not a lot of motion, and you end up with a more fluid gaming experience and less tearing and jitter, which we'll talk about later. The next one is quick frame transport, actually, and then we'll, okay, so let's go through variable refresh rate. So basically what ends up happening is the game, the computer, your graphics, your GPU can only render frames at a certain rate. And what happens is sometimes it'll be rendering a frame, advance it one more time, Gene, and all of a sudden it says, no, we need to move on. And what you end up with is tearing, where it was rendering a frame, and then all of a sudden it's got to jump to a new frame. And you end up with what's called tearing in a scene. And you could see there, if it was closer, you could kind of see, like, it's almost like there's two frames that are be starting. The other thing is you can get jitter. What happens, it's rendering a frame, and then all of a sudden it says, I don't have time, I'm just going to show that same frame again and then start working on the next one. And you end up with jitter. So you don't get, so this gives you tearing, and it can give you jitter, kind of because the computer the TV's asking for something different than what the computer is providing. When it comes to variable refresh rate, the computer or the gaming system or the video system talks to the TV, and the TV's frame rate changes based on what the PC can deliver. So you could be playing a game, and if you look at this, you bring up the little on screen on your computer, you'll see the rendering of the frames will change. 120, 50, 24, 10, and you'll see it. And the two communicate to make sure that when the computer is ready to share a frame, that's when the TV moves on to the next frame. So that's what variable refresh rate is. This makes a better gaming experience. So it just, and that's what that talks about. The computer waits until the TV waits until the computer tells it, I'm ready to give you another frame. Now, that communication has to be supported by the source, which is the game system, the sync, which is the TV, and the repeater has to be able to pass that information on. If all three of those things do not support that, it does not work. Now, there are variable refresh rate technologies already out there. FreeSync, which I think is AMD, and G-Sync, which is NVIDIA. Both of those are variable refresh rate technologies. What this is now they're trying to come up with a standardized version. So those two are proprietary, and they work really, really well. And they realize that those enhance the gaming experience. So let's come up with a standard that everybody could utilize. So that's the difference between those and with the variable refresh rate you're seeing here.
Now, the source on here, this is still a video game when it says 12 bits, right?
Yeah, it's the video game. Now, remember, you can crank up the 12 bits, but as you crank up bit rate or resolution, or frame rate, the file sizes gets bigger. So yes, computers can render 12, so most likely it is a video game. But like I said, this is more of a video game type of thing we're talking about here.
Gotcha.
Okay. The next thing is what's called quick frame transport. What ends up happening is, say the computer builds the frame. Currently, that frame is ready to go, but it has to wait for that next slot that it can send it down the HDMI cable. So what happens is, even though it's sitting there, it's waiting to be sent down to the TV, which slows down, it adds lag. So what they decided to do is, if you go to the next, build the next thing, is soon as that frame is done, it sends it to the HDMI cable. The HDMI cable sends it down the line. And so it just kind of speeds up the, it reduces the amount of lag. That's the thing. If you're a gamer, I come around the corner, you come around the corner. This ensures that I see you before you see me, because the signal got sent from the computer to my, or my game system to my TV, and my TV is showing me the picture faster. Mm-hmm. Okay. So those two are, those, like we see, these are all gaming things. I'm not sure if you really care that you're, that when you're watching a movie, that your frame, it switches from one scene to another a few milliseconds quicker. But if you're playing gaming, you want that advantage.
Well, one thing I'm wondering is, does lip sync correction get better with HDMI 2.1 than it does with what we're dealing with in older versions?
It could be, that is possible. I haven't even thought about that, Gene, but it could be possible, because normally what ends up happening is a lag between the video and the audio. And normally the video is going through processing and the audio does not, and you end up with a little bit of lag. Because of all these things that they're using to speed up that transfer of video, it's more likely that the video and the audio can get there at the same time.
Awesome. Like that.
Okay. So that may be the advantage to a movie person, if you have is better syncing of audio and video.
Right.
The next thing is auto low latency mode. If you look at every TV and you look at most receivers, and even a lot of projectors, they have a game mode. And the game mode, basically what they do is they turn off a lot of the video processing, because the longer it goes through a video process, it's like a maze. So I have to go over here to color enhancement, and then resolution enhancement, and then noise reduction. So it's not a straight path. It takes longer. By turning those off, you go straight down the line and you end up with, it's faster. But what you used to have to do is, if I was playing a game, I have to pick up my remote control on my TV, put it in game mode, pick up the remote from my receiver, which is my repeater, and put it in game mode. Now what ends up happening is, I'm using my Xbox to watch Netflix. Which is the repeater, and the sync, which is the TV, is using all of its video enhancement capabilities. The second I stop Netflix and I fire up a game, the source, which is the game, tells the repeater I'm a game. And the repeater switches into game mode automatically, and then the TV, which is the sync, switches in automatically. As a consumer, what does it mean for you? Optimized gaming and optimized video watching automatically. The TVs will, the system will do it for yourself. You don't have to continually grab your remote control and make those adjustments.
Gotcha. Okay. I didn't even realize in the receiver you actually have a game mode that'll basically defeat the IP scaler and the lip sync.
Yeah. Yeah. So we have a game mode in there that you can, in our receivers, that you can turn those things off. But a lot of times people aren't going to go in there and do that every single time. So it's nice that it's going to be automatic.
Okay.
Okay. Now those are things that, there's some advantages to maybe a gaming, to movies, but they're more of gaming focus. The two that, if you're a movie watcher, you're probably going to utilize the most is, like we talked about last week, enhanced audio return channel, EARC, the better version of audio return channel. And then of course, what's called quick media switching. And we'll talk about what both of these are. So let's talk about EARC first. Well, we're not even going to change the slide. EARC, basically, ARC, audio return channel, it came out a while back for your HDMI to send signals from a internal TV's sources or a component that is directly connected to a TV back down the line to a receiver or a soundbar. And the benefit of using ARC through your HDMI over optical is, many TV sets will not pass surround sound from the TV to a receiver using an optical cable. There's very few. Sony's would do it on is probably the only one. Most of the other ones, if you use that optical cable to connect your TV to your receiver or soundbar, even though the TV says Atmos or it has all those capabilities, what's coming down that pipe is stereo or Pro Logic.
Well, and the reason for that, because I went through this personally when I set up my mom's system, she was running optical from her TV out to the receiver. We were only getting two-channel stereo, even though it said it was in surround. The only way to get two-channel stereo is you have to shut off the internal speakers of the TV. So you would have to flip between. So you're saying if you run the eARC, you'll never have to turn off the internal speakers on a TV anymore.
Yeah.
It'll automatically shut the speakers off on the TV in favor of the receiver, right?
Yes. Because what ended up happening before, if you think about it, was the optical was the signal that fed the optical was taken after the DDA conversion for the speakers. So when the speakers were on, they didn't work, you know? So this is before all of that. So you don't have to worry about that type of stuff. So that was the first thing. But even that, which would give you Atmos and DTS:X, it was still a compressed version of those immersive audio formats. It wasn't the best, you know, Dolby True HD and DTS Master Audio. With enhanced audio return channel, they can send more bandwidth down that pipe, and you can get the same quality of DTS:X or IMAX Enhance or Dolby Atmos that you would have gotten from a Blu-ray if the source in the TV has it. So say you go out and you buy the TV could have eARC, the receiver could have eARC, but if Netflix is not running that level of content down in the app in the TV, you may not get it. Okay. So it doesn't mean that everything, because you plug it in, every piece of Netflix is going to be uncompressed audio. That's not the case. It depends. If it's able to give it to you, it will give it to you.
Gotcha. Okay.
Okay. Now, now let's move on to quick media switching, which is the next slide here.
Okay.
It's easier for the graphics. What this does is this is the thing that people hate. What ends up happening is whenever you switch from one frame rate to another on a source, sometimes you'll get that blank screen on your TV. Most of us have it. And so say the menu is 60p, but the video you're watching on Netflix is 24p, you get a blank. And when you stop the movie, you may get another blank. That is because each time you switch from one frame rate to another frame rate, there has to be that communication again, verification of rights and all that type of stuff. And you end up with this blank screen. This is one of the reasons why Apple TV, if you buy a 4K Apple TV, it makes everything 4K HDR 60p, everything. I don't care if it was... If what's actually on the what's actually being sent by Netflix is HD 24p, the Apple TV upconverts it to 4K 60p, so you wouldn't get the annoying blanking when you switch from one piece of content to another.
But it's not doing frame interpolation, is it? It's just
it's a really bad. The best way I can say it is, you're a streaming box that costs a couple of hundred bucks is taking your 24p stuff and making it 60p. Soap opera effect. And then it's upscaling. So if you have an Apple TV, I'll give you a big tip. Go into the Apple TV and set it to match frame rate and match format. And what that does is that ensures that when you go from the menu system to the movie's being played in proper frame rate and the proper resolution, but the screen will blank.
Right.
So that's the sacrifice. You got to wait a few minutes or a few seconds more before the movie starts. So but they realized that the average consumer would think the thing was broken. So that's why they did that.
Gotcha. Okay.
Okay. The next thing, remember how we talked about that G-Sync and FreeSync are just proprietary versions of variable refresh rate.
Right.
Well, Dolby Vision and HDR 10 Plus are proprietary versions of dynamic metadata. Now, dynamic metadata is part of the standard. Okay, you have to support it, and there'll be kind of a standard on how to do it. If you don't understand what the benefits of this is, it's pretty simple. There's three things that come down the line to tell from the source to tell your TV that it's HDR. The first thing is an info frame, which tells the TV to switch its brightness curves and its color spaces to match as closely as possible what's in the content. The next thing that comes down the line is what's called max fall and max CLL. And what those are is the brightest pixel in the entire movie. It tells the TV and the brightest, the average frame brightness of the brightest frame in the movie. So say I'm looking at this Harrison Ford movie right here. It says, okay, that's the brightest frame in the movie. And it is, the overall average brightness of that frame is 400. And there's one pixel way in the back that is 4,000. That is the information that would be shared for the TV, and the TV would make all of his adjustments. But if you look at the scene to the left, that's also in the movie. And that brightness is much, much lower, and the brightest pixel in that scene is much, much lower. And what you're doing is you're using the wrong information for that particular scene. So dynamic metadata, each frame, it provides the brightness and the brightness information. And if it's Dolby Vision, it will tell the TV specifically how to do it. So you basically end up with optimized HDR for every single frame of the movie. So
as opposed to now, I've noticed when you try to play native HDR content on most displays, the black scenes get too dark unless you go in and really tweak out the calibration. So you're saying,
and if you bring up the black scenes, you end up blowing out the highlights.
Yeah, and it looks terrible. It looks artificial
because you're trying to bounce. The worst is projectors. Eventually, if they can do dynamic metadata on projectors, your experience watching HDR on projector would be 50 times better. I review projectors, and That's one of the biggest false things is this is all this brightness, and you're trying to shove it into the brightness range of this projector, and it has the wrong information to do it.
Very interesting. Okay.
So that's all the different stuff. So you end up with better HDR, quicker switching between video, right? You end up with better audio from internal sources, which are built into the display, or if you plug your game system directly into your TV, you'll get the best audio that source can provide, okay? So those are all movie-based things that everybody could enjoy, all right?
Yeah, and I could just tell you the biggest thing is getting the 5.1 out of your sources from your TV, because I have so many people complain they're not in surround sound when they do that, either using just regular HDMI before this just toss link.
Exactly. Okay. So when it comes to 2.1 features, these type bandwidth requires a whole new level of construction because I'm using different channels in the cable, which we talked about last week. That's a hardware thing. Some of these other things can be done via firmware updates or can be planned for because it doesn't dramatically increase the bandwidth that's going down the standard line. So you should be able, it's kind of a, something they would that a 2.1 device should do, but it doesn't mean that an older 2.0B device cannot do it. And for example, Denon and Marantz receivers that are already in the market for the last few years already have ER capability and auto low latency mode capability right now. So if you go to the next slide, there is a huge amount of products. So you can see starting in 2017, we have receivers and AV processors that support EARC that are already ready, that already have this. So if you went out and bought that 8K TV and plugged your PlayStation in, you can plug it into a 5012 or a AVR, a Denon X2400, and take advantage of that.
So the SR8012 doesn't support this because I don't see it on the list.
Remember it says and above. So AVR 3400 and above, SR 6012 and above.
Oh, good.
So,
okay.
So everything above that supports it. Okay.
Awesome. I'm covered. I got an SR 8012 myself.
I got an AV 8805. So I was thinking about that too. Guy back there. Okay. So if you continue on the next thing, auto low latency mode, we have receivers from Denon and Marantz since 2014 that have this capability. So that's kind of nice to know that there's already those technologies built into the products you already have right now. Can they do 4K at 120 frames per second or 8K 60? No. But if you're not a gamer, who cares? You know? Mm-hmm. So it's nice to know that takes that receiver you already have and it can extend its usefulness for a longer time. All right.
So in the case if you are a gamer and you have one of these older receivers, would you just run a separate HDMI cable between your display and your game system? And
yeah, exactly. Why don't we move?
How would you get audio to it then?
Well, I gave you a couple of examples. I think they're next. So we talk about the bandwidth And let's get to this first. So yeah, one of the things is the bandwidth, and it's 48 gives you all of this frame rate, all this uncompressed 8K 60 and 4K 120. But if we go to the next slide, I have to give you some realism or some reality. Number one, with the exception of game systems, there's no external HDMI 2.1 movie sources announced or available. The Blu-ray physical media is not big enough, does not have enough capacity to store it, which means you would be like a Laserdisc and you'd be changing the Laserdisc, your Blu-ray, four times to watch a movie if they tried to use the current thing. The next thing is there's no standalone streaming devices announced. No Roku, no 8K Rokus, no 8K Apple TVs. The next thing is there's no satellite or cable set-top boxes that have been announced. Now it's the chicken and the egg. They're not going to make the box until there's content. The studios aren't, most of the content you want to watch are movies. Movie theaters are 4K. So no movie theater. So most companies, most production companies, most major studios, Warner Brothers, Sony, whatever, are not really in the enthusiastic about spending 50 to 100% more to make an 8K movie that should get them no more extra money inside of a theater, because that is where they make their money. They make $1 billion in the theater and then they sell you the Blu-ray. So they shoot it in it, but them actually mastering in it and delivering in 8K, they're hesitant. The next thing, cable companies. We're still waiting for 4K channels on most cable companies, because a 4K channel is the equivalent of four HD channels. If they're not going to give you four, if they're not going to give up four HD channels to give you 4K, they're not going to give up 16 HD channels to give you 8K. So until there's a new compression scheme, and until the movie theaters switch to a more of an 8K type projection system, content that kind of content is going to be limited. So most likely it's going to be 4K YouTube, or TV companies, like I said, are going to pay to be the first to deliver content to internal services in their TV, or somebody like Netflix or Disney Plus or Hulu or Amazon are going to shoot something in 8K to differentiate themselves from the broadcasters. So most of that stuff is built into the TV.
Okay? Yeah, didn't you say there was one TV that was going to do native 8K or something through one of the streaming apps in our last presentation?
Well, there are some, like, for example, like people bring up YouTube 8K. Yes, there's this 8K YouTube content, but most of the, I don't know of a single internal TV app that can support 8K. So it takes the 8K, knocks it down to 4K, and then your 8K TV upscales it back to 8K. That's where we're at right now. Okay. Gotcha. So, So this is what we're talking about. Okay. So most of the time, most people are only going to have, we already talked about, there's only pretty much two sources that are going to be in 8K, 8K and 4K 120. Your game system, your two game systems. Most people want their game system next to their TV. So you plug that into the TV and you get all the things we talked about. If that TV is capable of it, I have to point this out. Just because a TV has HDMI 2.1, this drives me crazy, it doesn't have to do all of the things. For example, Samsungs have variable refresh rate and they can do things. They'll be doing everything. I know they can do variable refresh rate, and I think they're looking at doing something like QMS, but they don't do eARC, right? The Sony TV does eARC, but it may not do, you know, so it's all these, each brand you're going to have to go to and look at. And by the way, even if you go into a brand and you pick a model, each model has its own different capabilities. So Sony, Samsung, LG, Hisense, you're going to have to really look. And when they say 2.1, you have to find out what features in 2.1 can you do?
So okay? That doesn't make any sense to me. If you're going to adhere to a standard, why wouldn't you have all those features in that standard?
Yeah, you would think that in order to get that stamp of approval of 2.1, you got to be able to do it all. So now it says, so what you hear is features, this TV has features that are part of the HDMI certification. That's why you never see HDMI 2.1 on anything. Nothing certified 2.1. None of the cables you'll ever see 2.1. And I have all these cables we'll talk about next week. Same thing with the TVs. Okay. But anyway, you're going to plug the game system in. You'll get everything that TV can do. And it's going to send the sound out to the receiver via eARC. That could be a brand new receiver or a receiver that you bought this year, last year from us. Okay. So if you go to long as you use the eARC or the ARC, okay, it'll work. You're going to get surround sound from that. So if you continue to the next slide, if the TV has an internal app and that internal app can actually do 8K, it's internal. So you still got to send the audio to the receiver and guess which way you're going to use it, ARC or eARC.
Can you quickly define again, just in case anybody missed it, what's the difference between ARC and eARC? What do you get with eARC that you don't have with ARC?
More bandwidth, which means the audio is not compressed. So you're just like so it can deliver Atmos at Dolby True HD.
But ARC DTS:X Pro can ARC do Atmos or can ARC do
ARC can do Atmos, but remember there's two different levels of Dolby. There's Dolby True HD and I can't remember what the other one is. Like you should know. You do this all the time. Dolby Digital Plus. So right now it delivers Atmos in Dolby Digital Plus. With eARC, if it has the Dolby True HD version in the app, you get that.
Gotcha. Okay. I haven't seen any streaming devices do True HD Atmos. I've only seen them do Dolby Digital Plus. Yeah. I might be wrong, but I haven't seen True HD.
You probably haven't, but until there was eARC devices, eARC TVs, and eARC components, what was the motivation for somebody like Netflix or Disney Plus to do it?
Right, that's true.
There wasn't. So that's a different conversation. So it's the old, I can't tell you what, I can't tell you when. Okay. Gotcha. The next thing I want to point out, just like I said, never use an optical cable because you're only going to get a stereo or Dolby Pro Logic. A lot of these balance, we're going to talk about balance next week, good balance and okay balance. A lot of these balance don't support eARC and they definitely don't even support ARC. So you may have this balance. I learned this the hard way. It's one of the reasons I got this big rack behind me and I'm always swapping cables out. And I switched to, first I had a big long copper cable. And when I went to 4K, wasn't the bandwidth that died. So I went out and bought balance. And oh my gosh, it worked. And it worked until, it worked for 4K until HDR came out. Then it died. Then I went out and got new balance that were 4K HDR. I plugged them in. And it worked brilliantly until I said, man, the new these Sony TVs have the IMAX enhanced privileged player built in. So they have this movies and IMAX enhanced in the Sony TV. I want to hear that on my Marantz 8805. No sound. So I had to go get new balance that supported not only 4K HDR, but also ARC at a minimum so I can get the sound from the TV's internal app to my rack back here.
Does the same thing apply now? If you're doing a video distribution system in your house, so you don't want to run HDMI throughout your house, you're building a new construction, you're going to run video distribution. You might have one Ultra HD Blu-ray and one or two streaming devices all plugged into this video distribution thing like AV Pro Edge or something like that. Do you have to worry about if those devices have eARC or should they have them by default since if they support the latest in HDMI?
There are some high-end switching systems that support ARC through video distribution, but they're still pretty rare. It's one of those questions you have to ask. When I go to trade shows, 3 years ago, I went and said, show me 20-meter cables that support 18 gigabits. I need all the other stuff. Just tell me that. And then a year and a half ago, I said, about 2 years ago at CDI, I said, show me 20-meter solutions that support ARC. And then it was only a few of them. Now it's going to be show me 20 meter solutions that can be, that can support 48 and eARC. And that's when it's going to get even harder and harder to support that stuff.
Crazy.
Okay. Oh, Eamon said, the question is, if my TV only has one HDMI input that supports 2.1, would I be able to buy a splitter in the future to support that input? Yes, you will. There'll be splitters out there that can do that as well. So, and that splitter that switch will probably be less than if you have a really high-end receiver to replace. And you have to balance that. You may look at it and say, you want, $1,000 for a switch? why don't I just buy a new receiver? And that's something that you're going to have to weigh out, because the surround sound modes are great. It's just, it's that balance between what I have now and what is it going to take to get all the sources to do it. And unless Eamon's got both game systems, you're not going to have that problem. Okay. Or do something like this, buy an X8500 or an AV8805 right now. Those are HDMI 2.0 B devices right now. And when you do get the two sources, then we can send this back to us, to our facility in upstate New York, I believe. And they will actually, there's an upgrade board that we're going to be offering for this. The price and timing will be determined, and we will turn this sucker into a 2.1 device.
So let me ask you an important question for anyone considering buying an X8500 or AV8805 in the near future. Mm-hmm. When you guys announce the upgrade board, will the models that are being shipped at that time also be already upgraded, or would you buy it with the old board and you still have to send it back in to upgrade?
There will probably be a replacement for these that I have the board built in.
So but it won't be an 8500 Rev 2. It might be an 8600 at that point.
I can't. There's probably somebody on the phone that would yell at me if I tell you what the model number is. But yeah, they will.
I'm just making in general.
There will be an upgrade. These pieces were designed to live a long, prosperous life. Right. So from the beginning, they built them that way. Somebody asked about their 8012. Unfortunately, they won't be able to do that. But it was just, if you're going to buy a flagship, the best Denon receiver ever made and the best Marantz pre-pro ever made, you should have that option.
So you're going to get me in trouble with our readers now, because I've been pimping the SR8012 for so many years because I love that receiver. And that's the one that's not on this upgrade list.
Well, let's talk about it. Unless the person is a gamer and they want to plug in more than two or three sources into a TV, which don't exist, that 8012 is still a great piece.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. You have to think about that. When is it going to be time to upgrade? And when you go in there and you see an 8012 and its successor, or I'm going to buy it right now, ask yourself, am I a gamer? If I'm not really a gamer, maybe I should just grab the 8012 right now and enjoy it for a couple of years.
Or worst case, plug the game system directly into your TV and use the eARC.
Exactly. So if you continue on, a couple more things. So yeah, so there's going to be all the things the receiver can support. You know, we'll be all of the, you'll have basically standard, enhanced, and 8K enhanced, kind of the settings in a receiver, because 8K enhanced is different communication than 4K enhanced or 4K standard. This adjustment allows it to be more backwards compatible. Okay. So you will probably have to go into the menu and set the receiver for that 8K source. You know, that if you're going to be switching it to 8K enhanced.
So you'd have to do that manually each time?
No, just for the one time for that.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Because because it needs to know, hey, this is how I'm using an HDMI cable. So it needs to know for that source, it needs to be this.
Gotcha.
Okay. And then of course, the big thing too, is a lot of these things that you're getting, it's kind of hard to know if you're getting them or not. So what will end up happening is, if you go to the next slide, they'll be like, these are just kind of ideas that we're thinking about. You'll be able to see things like what functions and what benefits are in that particular signal and then that format. Does that make sense? So you can see it says out of the latency mode. So it'll say I'm watching something, and this is all the stuff that's available in that particular thing that you're looking at.
So just by hitting the info button or something on the receiver remote. Yeah,
exactly. Because this machine here will tell you, but it's like $7,000. So it'd be kind of nice to know that I'm getting all that I can get from my video signal by using hitting the display information button on the ABR.
And I'm sure you also have an info button for audio. So if you could see if you're in True HD or Dolby Digital Plus over Atmos.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And last but not least, because we're going to talk about this tomorrow, next week, because I don't want to run out of, I'm sure we're past the time. The longer your cables, the more problems you're going to have with moving bandwidth back and forth. And next week, we're going to talk about all these different cables and how you can test them and which ones work and which ones don't. Oh, by the way, I know people have a lot more questions about this stuff. I got to give myself a shout out. I also have a little YouTube channel. It's called Sound United Training. So on YouTube, go to Sound United Training. We have whole things in there about smart remote management, detailed conversations about HDMI 2.1, Rune integration with multi-zone. I did a whole thing this week about, I have 15 zones in my house, and how to make sure that 15 zones of audio work efficiently. So if you want to really get into the tech, there's stuff in there too. So that's Sound United Training on YouTube. That's our YouTube channel, Sound United
Training. So I'll link it up. If you want to just send me the link later, I'll link it up and annotate it in the video so people can go to it.
Okay. So we always seem to go over.
Yeah. No, we're right at 40 minutes. I think that's
okay.
Good.
Okay.
What I think we'll do is we'll stop here. We'll come back next week and hopefully the presentation will be a little shorter so we can come in and answer some questions. It looks like our audio stream got better, so I'm glad it's still not breaking up, but I know people will complain regardless. Yes. But anyway, Phil, thank you very much for coming here and doing this for us. This HDMI business is not easy to digest.
It's
changed so much over the years. I'm still like grasping HDMI 1.4 and above, and now we're already on 2.1.
But well, I learn something new every day too, so it's amazing.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, it's just I like the direction. I like the fact that we can get easier 5.1 signals out of our streaming from the TV now, and it's just going to probably have a lot less field calls for people when they do these installs.
So guys,
again, thanks, Phil. Thanks to Sound United for coming here and doing this presentation. I'm going to put these slideshows up on our Patreon channel. So if you guys become a member, you get access to these slideshows if you want to go over this at your own leisure. Mm-hmm. Don't forget about our Patreon at patreon.com/audioholics. We will see you next week. And Phil, we'll be ready for you next week. Hopefully we'll have better audio this time.
Yes. So, and I see there's some stuff in the stream that I can answer for people. He's asked like, and I have no problems jumping in there and answering some of the tech when I'm bored on Saturday. Just don't get too care. I can answer technical video questions about what's the new model number coming out and how much is it going to cost. I can't do that. All right. I'm not going to do that.
Yeah,
I can't tell you what, I can't tell you when. I can explain technology.
You can tell them.
Exactly. All right. So take care and I will talk to you guys soon.
All right. Until next time, my friends.